Okay, thank you. So I have to apologize to speak about RAB GTPS, what you said? No.
No. No.
Don't.
Okay.
I'll apologize for you.
Okay, thank you. No, I want to thank Neva for this, for organizing this this meeting. I think it's a great opportunity to interact with mathematicians. And I should say, actually, I am in charge of a big program that, I mean, gathers several institutes in Paris. And, I mean, the goal of this program is to foster the interaction between biologists, physicists, mathematicians, and chemists, actually, for this. So it's a good opportunity to set up meeting like that. So as Cathy says, so I'm mainly going to talk about our favorite RAB GTPS, which is RAB 6. So you already heard yesterday from Jiangxi Shen and Judith Kompleman about RAB GTPS. And so, but I will just briefly introduce you again this this family of protein. So RAB GTPS belongs to what is called the RAS superfamily. So as you know, this superfamily contains many proteins. So you have RAS by themselves, you have the RORAC CDC42, SAR1, and this RAB family. So all these proteins that are also called small GTPs have exactly the same structure. So they have a molecular weight of between 20 and 25, and all carry this conserved domain that are involved in GTP binding and GTP hydrolysis. And actually, the RAB GTPs is the largest family of this RAS superfamily. So as you heard yesterday, there is about 70 members that has been identified in human. And actually, we don't know the exact function of most of them. So this slide shows you, what we believe are the main function of RAB GTPs. So in fact, there is two main functions which are related to each other. So one of the functions is to regulate virtually all transport steps between cell compartments. So RAB GTPs are involved in the budding of this so-called transport vesicle that move shuttle from one compartment of the cell to the other. So they are involved in the movement of this transport vesicle along macrotubule or actin cytoskeleton. So one of the main effectors of RAB GTPs are molecular motor, myosin or kinesin. And then RAB GTPs are also involved in targeting of these vesicles to a so-called acceptor membrane. And in particular, they recruit a protein, a complex of protein called tethering factor. And another point that will not be addressed in this call is that, in fact, there is a cycle of this RAB GTPs between cytosol and membrane. And this cycle is coupled to the GDP-GTP activation. So another important role of RAB GTPs is to form membrane domains. And these membrane domains are very important for, I mean, they are used as signaling platform and probably for many other cell functions. And one of the best examples is RAB5 GTPs, which is located on early endosomes. And this RAB5 GTPs, I mean, recruit a series of proteins that at the end form so-called RAB5 domain on early endosome membrane. Okay, so this is outlook of my talk today. So if I have time, so we talk about the mechanism that allows the formation of RAB6 positive vesicle from Golgi TGN membrane. Some evidence that we have now, so it's not yet published, that RAB6 could be a general regulator of post-Golgi trafficking. And then, if I have time, so now we have generated many mouse model to study the function of flop 6 in specific cell lineage or tissue. Okay, so WRAP6 is one of the main, there is five or six proteins, RAPGTPase, that are conserved throughout the evolution from yeast to mammals and human. And WRAP6 is one of this gene. So I am not going into detail, but in fact there is four isoforms of WRAP6. And I will mainly speak today about these two isoforms that we call WRAP6A and WRAP6A prime. Actually, it's a unique example among the WRAP family. So these two isoforms are generated by alternative splicing of the same gene. And in fact, the two proteins are very, very close for this. And still, we don't know exactly. They are localized to exactly the same compartment in the cells. And but I mean, they are probably different function. Okay, so work from my laboratory for many years and other has reached this model for WRAP6 function. So WRAP6 at the steady state is localized at the Golgi complex and mainly on the trans site of the Golgi and the TGN, trans-Golgi network membrane. So WRAP6 is in fact regulate several transport steps at this level. So one of these transport steps, I will not go into talk today about, is so-called retrograde transport. So it's a pathway that connects the endosomal system, so sorting endosome or recycling endosome, to the Golgi. And this pathway is used by, of course, endogenous protein to recycle, but also, for instance, some toxin like Shiga toxin to enter the cell and to intoxicate the cell. The other function of WRAP6 I will illustrate in a moment is to regulate so-called enterograde transport, so it's a transport from TGN membrane to the plasma membrane. And WRAP6 is also involved in retrograde transport between Golgi and the plasmic reticulum. Okay, so first part of my talk is to present data on the mechanisms that underlie the formation of WRAP6 positive vesicle from Golgi TGN membrane. Okay, so what we published several years ago is that the actomyosin system is required for. So I will show you for this function. So this is the normal situation. So it's control cell. So by the way, this has been done in cells that express stably express GFP, WRAP6A or WRAP6A prime. So this is a cell, so this is a Golgi, and this is all these vesicles that move away or go back to the Golgi. So this is a normal situation. Now, if you block myosin 2 with inhibitor, so what you start to see is the appearance of these tubes that are still connected with the Golgi membrane. And in fact, the tube correspond to vesicles that cannot fission from the Golgi. So in fact, when you, it has been shown, so we have shown that in vitro a long time ago with Patricia. So if you pull on a membrane with a molecular motor, so you need, of course, microtubule. So if you inhibit the fission event, you see the formation of this membrane tube. Okay, so now we have tried to understand in further detail how this might work. And actually, so what we have done recently is to look carefully what is happening in this, at the level of the Golgi. So again, so this is, so now it's a zoom on the Golgi complex. So this is WAP6 and the Golgi. And if you look carefully, so this is all these vesicles that bud from Golgi membrane. And in fact, if you look carefully, you see that the majority of vesicles always form from the same place at the Golgi. So it's what we call hotspot of for vesicle formation at the Golgi. So this is shown in more detail on the on this slide. So this is taken from the same movie. So you can track these vesicles. And for instance, if you look here, you see that one vesicle is moving, then another one is forming at the same at the same place. And also, what you can show is that if you treat the cell with blebbistatin, that we block myosin II activity. So as I show you, you see this this tube that are connected to the Golgi membrane due to fission defect. So in fact, this process is reversible. So you can wash out blebbistatin, and then the circuitry pathway start again, and then you start to make, I mean, the tubes disappear and you make vesicles again. And if you look carefully, you can see that these membrane tubes also form at this hotspot of on Golgi membrane. Okay, so the question was to understand how this Golgi fission hotspot can be formed. And so we wonder if there could be a connection between the actin and microtubule network to explain this this hotspot. So so as I told you, so myosin II, we believe, is involved in this process. And in fact, a long time ago, we also shown that RAP6 interact with a kinesin. At that time, we called RAP kinesin 6. Now it's called in the literature KIF-28 or MKLP2 because it's an important motor during cell division. And if you, so we address this issue recently and look at the localization of KIF-28 on Golgi. And as you can see, you can detect a pool of KIF-28 that is localized, co-localized with a Golgi marker GN130 or TGN46, which is present on this Golgi membrane. And in fact, there is a specific inhibitor of KIF-20A, which is called paprotrin. Now, actually, this inhibitor is used by a small company to develop anti-cancer, to block mitosis in cancer cells. In a way, to our surprise, because at the beginning we believed that this kinesin was a kinesin that will move this vesicle, RAP6 vesicle, along microtubule. But in fact, it's not the case, because when you inhibit ATPase activity of kinesin with this inhibitor, you also see the appearance of these membrane tubes that I described with after inhibition of myosin II, meaning that KIF-20A was also involved in the fission process of this vesicle. Okay, and then so to we try to do is to look at precisely the localization of this protein, so myosin light chain, so myosin II, GFU, RAP6, and KIF-20A. So you treat the cell with this inhibitor, and then you look at the where the protein are localized on these membrane tubes, and you can see that at the basis of this tube, you can detect Rap 6, Amazing 2, and Kif 28. I mean, there was an argument to say that maybe the three protein could be involved in this fission machine. And actually, so work from our laboratory and other has also shown that, in fact, these three proteins, so we know that Rap6 interact with Kif 28, Rap6 interact also directly with myosin 2, and in fact, myosin 2 also interact with Kif 28. So there is a complex network of interaction between the three proteins. And so to go further, so what we can show is that there is a complex between the three proteins that you can, I mean, this is you can immunoprecipitate the three proteins. And also what we have been able to show is that in fact to have an interaction between Kif 28 and myosin 2, you require Rap6. So this is shown just in this panel. So this is a classical experiment. So this is done. So it's a cell actually that express GFP Kif 28. So you do an IP. So you can see that you have myosin. You can immunoprecipitate myosin 2 with Kif 28. GFP or endogenous. Now, if you remove Rap6 by siRNA, you see that you cannot immunoprecipitate myosin 2 anymore, meaning that Rap6, you need Rap6 for the interaction between the two the two proteins. Then what we can show shown also is that Kif 28 is in fact required for the recruitment of myosin 2 on Golgi membrane. So this is shown in this experiment. So this is the control situation. So you quantify the signal of myosin 2 that you can see at the Golgi membrane. If you, of course, if you remove myosin 2 by siRNA, you have no more signal. If you remove Rap6 A and A prime also, you decrease myosin 2 at the Golgi, meaning that Rap6 is involved in the recruitment of myosin 2 at the Golgi. But if you remove Kif 20A, you also decrease the amount of myosin 2 at the Golgi. Okay, so then, I mean, to better understand what was going on, so we did we treat the cell with nocodazole, and then we made an experiment called regrowth of macrotubules. So as you know, the Golgi membrane are able to nucleate macrotubules, and these macrotubules are in fact used for post-Golgi trafficking from the Golgi. So if you do that, you can also show that. So you treat the cell with nocodazole, and then you remove the drug, and then you can see that Kif 28 can colocalize on this growing macrotubule from the Golgi membrane. And the last experiment that I want to show you before the model is a FRAP experiment. So actually, what we have done is to FRAP. So this is Rap6. So you frap the Golgi, and then you look at the Rap6 signal, and you look at the recovery of fluorescence, and then you compare. So this is so you measure in fact the diffusion of Rap6 in the plane of the plasma membrane. So if you use if you treat the cell with this Kif 28 inhibitor, you see that you decrease the half-time of recovery, meaning that in fact the diffusion is is faster in when you inhibit Kif 28. So and so I will show you the model. Yeah. So also, I mean to understand, we measure the relative affinity between the two the three proteins. So I show you the model. So what we believe is going on is the following. So this is a Golgi membrane, a TGN membrane. So I think that the first event is, so WAP6 is diffusing on the plane of the Golgi of the of the membrane, and then WAP6 probably recruit first KIF20A and then myosin 2, and then this makes a complex between the three protein, and then the vesicle form from Golgi membrane, and this vesicle move along macrotubules, and then the actin network is used to fission the vesicle from the Golgi membrane. So is a some is an example of and actually one of the very rare example of a probably a connection between Golgi between actin and macrotubule to form a vesicle from the Golgi. Okay, so my second part of the
to the previous slide, just 1 second, because we will move further. Sorry, what does 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 means? The
it
numbers.
It is a step.
Steps. But they go like in a circle?
No.
It's a model.
it's a model. So we put number to say, okay, so you have first WAP6, and then WAP6 recruit myosin 2, then recruit KIF28, and then this man.
And then what is the difference between 4 and 5? Ah, it is made.
For 4 and 5, you have this. So in 4, the system is in place. I mean, it's. And then the vesicle form, and then the vesicle. Is cut from the Golgi and then move away from the Golgi.
So it is not like it can be in any place. So it can because it go 1, 2, 3, 4 and then 5.
So maybe the model can be improved. I see what you mean. So this is. This is the hotspot if you want here, and then Yeah, it's a way to represent.
It's just the order of events.
It's the order of events.
It's not
partial. I mean, probably the event takes place at the same place, very close to. But to me.
Okay. One quick question: Do you think there's any involvement of a GTP cycle that would regulate really WAP6 in this model?
Yeah, I think there is probably a cycle. But the big problem with WAP6, we don't know exactly the gap and the gap, so it's difficult.
So if it would be blocked, it is not like would be working.
It is not like special distribution. It is anywhere.
No, it's not special. It's as Tommy says, the order of event.
Excuse me. I miss what myosin 2 is doing here. What is myosin 2 doing here? I didn't understand.
So what we believe is that myosin 2, so if you inhibit myosin 2, you cannot fission this vesicle. So we believe that myosin 2 is involved in the fission.
Do you know how? Any idea?
No. There are several hypotheses. So we try to, with Patricia actually, to reconstitute this assay in vitro on giant liposome. I mean, there are several possibilities. So, and also, we don't know exactly the actin organization at the Golgi. So we know there is actin around the Golgi, but I mean, how it is organized, if it is branch actin or actin filaments, I mean, I think this is not well known. So it could be that, I mean, one possibility, so maybe Patricia can explain better than me, that, I mean, maybe you have myosin 2 on the plane of the membrane, and then you have this contraction. And I mean, you have some studies that have shown that this contraction of myosin 2 can induce phase separation, for example, of lipids, and this phase separation could be directly involved in the fission process. But I mean, to be clear, we don't know.
Is the actin getting nucleated? Is there ARP23 or formins or WASH?
proteins.
Yeah, we know that amida is up to two in the Golgi. There is all, I mean, all the actin nucleator are present at the Golgi.
You need CDC42, right?
You need CDC42. And also, CDC42 is also involved somewhere in this.
Are they at the hot spots of this protein?
It's a good question. I think, we have done some staining with ARPT3, and it seems that this ARPT3 could be present at the hotspot, but it's not. Okay. Okay, so second part of my talk, which is not published, is some evidence that we have to say that RAPSIS could be a general regulator of post-Golgi traffic. So for this, we use an assay, so-called RUSH assay, that actually has been developed by the group of Frank Perez at the at the Institut Curie, the cell biology department. So in fact, it's an assay that is based on the avidin stratavidin system. So in brief, so you make a hook in the ER, and then you tag cargo with stratavidin binding protein. So in normal conditions, this will allow the retention of this cargo, circuitry cargo, in the ER. And then you just add biotin, the vitamin, in the medium. So, and then this association between the cargo and the hook in the ER is released, and the secretion is working. So I will show you. So, and you can do this with a wide variety of protein. So I will mainly talk today about three protein, three cargo that we follow. One is a GPI anchor protein. Another one is a transmembrane protein, TNF-alpha. And the last one is a soluble cargo, collagen 10, that we heard yesterday from Alberto's talk. Okay, so just to illustrate the RUSH system, so this is CD59. So this is the beginning of the experiment. So this is CD59 is present in the endoplasmic reticulum. So then you just add biotin to the medium, and what you can see that the protein leaves the ER, reach the Golgi, and then reach the plasma membrane. So it's a very nice way to synchronize transport between ER and the plasma membrane. And I can just show you also with collagen 10. So it's the same. So beginning of the experiment, collagen 10 is into the ER. Then you add biotin. Sorry. Then it reaches Golgi, and then you have this vesicle. And the collagen 10 is a soluble protein, so it's released into the medium. Okay, so doing that, so we look carefully using this assay, where actually the exocytosis takes place. So so just to illustrate with collagen 10, so this is the movie, so and I will show you. So this is an endoplasmic reticulum, so after 10 minutes, majority of the protein is in the Golgi, and then is reaching the plasma membrane and the extracellular medium. And actually, so I show you the movie, okay? And then, so at the end of the experiment, basically you see nothing, because probably collagen 10 has diffused out of the cells and it's going to the extracellular medium. So actually what we did is to coat, I mean, we device an assay. So in fact, so of course, the cells are grow on the cover slip, but you coat the cover slip with an antibody against GFP. So when the protein that is released in the medium, so after exocytosis, so if, I mean, all these cargo have GFP on it, and then, so the, because the cover slip is coated with anti-GFP, the protein that is secreted is in fact trapped at this site where exocytosis has occurred. So if you do that, you see, so again, the same experiment, so except it is shown, it is, it is done on coated cover slip, so again, so and now what we can see is that, so I can show you again the. The movie, so it's Golgi vesicle, and then at the end of the experiment, you see that in fact, exocytosis did not occur randomly at the plasma membrane, but in fact on what we can call also hotspot of exocytosis. And in fact, if you look carefully, so the pictures are not great, so they are better on my computer. But so if you if you stain the cell with paxillin, which is a marker of the focal adhesion, so where the cells adhere to the cover slip, you can see that most of the, I mean, all this, the cargo and the, are in fact exocytos, so reach the plasma membrane very close to this focal adhesion site. Now, if you look, okay, so this is a complicated slide, so I will go. So then what we, as you know, and maybe I did not say clearly, so post-Golgi trafficking depends on microtubules. All these vesicles move along microtubules to reach the plasma membrane. And then, so if you do this this experiment, you can in fact track all these vesicles with this different marker. And what we can, we are shown is that, so if you do this tracking experiment, so you can define the tracks that this vesicle that leaves the Golgi, reaching the plasma membrane near the focal adhesion site have used. So they use microtubule tracks, which is shown here. But in fact, they seem to use always the same microtubule. So there are many microtubules, but I mean, microtubule can be used several times to transport this this carrier. Okay, so to move further, so what we have done is to look what could be the machinery that is present near the focal adhesion site to sustain this endocytosis. So in fact, this has been shown 10 years ago by the group of Anna Akhmanova in now in Utrecht. So what is known in the field, so this is a microtubule, so this is a focal adhesion. And in fact, near the focal adhesion, and you have a link between the microtubules and this focal adhesion site. And in fact, one of the player of this formation of this site is a protein called ELKS, or also CAST, so it's a protein of the active zone in neuron. And this complex, in fact, allows an anchoring of microtubules near the focal adhesion site. And it turned out, in fact, that ELKS is a RAP6 effector. And so if you, so this experiment show you, so this is a controlled situation, so you can see this is GFP ELKS. Now, if you remove, so GFP ELKS, so it's localized on the plasma membrane, but it's also concentrated at the focal adhesion, as suggested by the model. But if you remove ELKS, case, with DP2L case by sRNA, you can see that in fact you lose this preferential targeting of exocytic marker to the plasma membrane. Okay, so this is quantified in this experiment. So you have some preferred site of exocytosis. You have this protein RAP6 effector ALKS that seems to be involved in this process. So then we look more carefully at what could be the role of RAP6 in this process. So so what we did is to use all the three cargos I was talking about, and then to quantify the amount of vesicles that carry TNF alpha collagen 10 that are also positive for RAP6. And so we look at different steps. One at the late stage, during exocytosis of this vesicle to the plasma membrane. And so this is my turf experiment. And if you quantify, you see that, over 70 or 80% of, for instance, the vesicles that contain CD59 are also positive for RAP6. So it's the same for collagen 10 or soluble TNF-alpha. Now, if you look at the Golgi exit, so at the first step, so you look, so this is the Golgi, and again, you quantify the vesicles that form from the Golgi membrane and how many contain RAP6. And as you can see, also the majority of these vesicles do contain RAP6. And it's the same in the vesicle en route to the plasma membrane. The vast majority of them are RAP6 positive. So, in fact, this was a bit surprising. We are not expecting this this result, that RAP6 will be present on many vesicles living. Sorry?
If you inhibit the myosin 2, as you showed before, and you track now the collagen guys,
yeah,
are the tubes containing a continuum of the collagen, or is it anything?
Yeah. For this, so we did this this experiment with all the cargo to inhibit myosin 2, and we see tubes, and this tube contains this cargo. Yeah. So
no, but the collagen we heard is making these long filaments, right? So is it?
This collagen 10. So the question is what is it?
Excuse me.
What is exactly your question? So is it?
The collagen is polymerizing these fibers, right? And so we heard in the Vivek's talk that there were this large cargo, right? So I'm curious, if you prevent the fission and you get these long tubes on this machinery, do you now see compartmentalized bits of collagen, or is it a continuum?
It's a good question. I think we did not, we should look carefully. So what we have seen is you see collagen in this tube, okay? It seems to be discontinuous. I agree, but to be honest, I did not pay attention to the organization of collagen in this tube. But maybe.
Do you know anything about the size? Similar question. Are the collagen vesicles look bigger than the other vesicles?
Yeah. So. Yeah, so this is collagen. So I think Vivek was using collagen 7, right?
There are only three collagens that make this long fiber. It's number 1, 2, and 3.
Okay.
Other collagens are big molecules, but they have kinks, so they can fold on themselves. So you don't expect
they are not
reaching.
Okay.
So is it collagen 7?
When you were doing these three movies that you showed to us, it appeared to me that the collagen was a very it's a synchronized exit from the Golgi, whereas the other ones was much more spread, right?
It's difficult to say, so I don't know exactly. No, it's
that's very sharp. You see, boom, gone, right?
Yeah.
But if you look at the CD59, it appeared to me much softer.
Yeah, yeah, maybe for this. So actually, Frank and is analyzing now in detail this, this all this type of movie to see if, what are exactly the kinetics and.
The vesicles look bigger on that.
They're brighter. That doesn't mean that
they're brighter.
Yeah, but you don't have the resolution.
And TNF alpha is a bit different. No, they are big also, right? So it's difficult to say first.
It's like watching fire.
Okay, so I show you this this slide. And then, of course, it was important to show that. So this has been shown already with VSVG, that what we use as a classical marker, is to look at. I mean, the effect of when you remove RAP6, what is the effect on the secretion. So I just show you the experiment done with TNF-alpha. So this is a control, and this is after depleting RAP6 by scRNA. And then you quantify the amount of TNF-alpha at the plasma membrane after removing RAP6, and you see that for instance, after 30 minutes or 60 minutes, you decrease by 50% the amount of TNF-alpha. So, in fact, RAP6 removal of RAP6 do not block secretion, but just delay secretion. So, for this. And also, what you can see, so this has been done with mouse embryonic fibroblasts. So we told you about this RAP6 knockout mice. So, and then in this case, you measure the total protein secretion. So you just label the cells, and then you look at the amount of protein that was released in the medium. And as you can see, after 1 hour, you see that more than 50% of the total protein in the medium has been inhibited. So this is again an argument to say that RAP6 is involved in transport of many types of proteins. Okay, and the last experiment that I want to show you was to the question was if RAP6 could be involved in sorting. So as you know, so we heard yesterday, one of the major functions of the TGN is to sort proteins. So the proteins are going to different destinations, to the plasma membrane, to endothelial system. And the dogma is that all these cargoes that go to different locations are sorted into different populations of vesicles. So what we did to know if RAP6 was involved in the sorting of cargo is to to express two or three cargo in cell and look at the vesicles that contain one cargo or two cargo. And what was the percentage of these vesicles that were positive for RAP6? So I just show you, I think this is with TNF-alpha. So if you look, so in yellow, so actually this, sorry, I cannot read it here, but I think TNF-alpha. okay, I don't know.
Don't rely on us.
It's TNF-alpha and CD59? Anyway, so it's not important, so because it's always the same. Okay, so let's say it's TNF-alpha and CD59. So you see that about 50 or 60% of vesicles contain the two cargo. Okay, and then you have about 20% of vesicles that contain only one cargo. Okay, so actually the percentage of vesicles that contain two cargo is very high. It's about 50%. But this can be due. So we talked yesterday about this massive. So probably there is a sorting between the two cargo. But because you increase there is a big flow of membrane at one point, probably you overcome the sorting machine. But still, you have 20% of vesicles that contain one cargo and 20% of the other cargo, meaning that the sorting go on and then take place. And then so we look at the percentage of vesicles, so they contain two cargo, only one cargo, that also carry WAP6. And in fact, this percentage is the same. So you have about 60% of vesicles containing two cargo that are positive for WAP6, but this is the same percentage of protein containing only, of vesicle containing one cargo. So this is an argument to say that, in fact, WAP6 is not involved in the sorting of this vesicle, but so the vesicles are formed, but they associate with, but WAP6 associate with this vesicle. Okay, and this is our model, so it's the same scheme than previously. So now, so this is the microtubule, so this is the adhesion. I mean the exocytic hotspot near focal adhesion. And so what we propose is that in fact this post-Golgi trafficking is controlled by a core machinery that is made by WAP6, WAP6 effector, and the microtubule. So again, this is done in non-polarized cells, so we don't know exactly what is going in what is going in polarized cells. So there are several hypotheses. So one, which is relatively simple, that this exocytic domain, I would say, simply reflect the global architecture of the cell, which is dictated by the organization of the actin and the microtubule network. Or maybe this also is due to functional links, and we know that they exist between Golgi membrane and focal adhesion, and these links, which are important for cell adhesion, polarization, and migration. Okay, so I have maybe it's gone. Can I have 5 minutes more, or maybe? Yes. Should I just show you? So as I told you at the beginning, so we try now to use. To study the function of WAP6 in the context of the organism, and so to do so, we have generated conditional WAP6 knockout mice. So this is a classical Quillox system, and in fact, WAP6 is an essential gene, and it's required for embryogenesis, and in fact, the mice that homozygous for WAP6 and null allele. In fact, they die at a day 5.5. And actually, the phenotype is exactly the same that you found when you knock out beta-1 integrin. So, if you look at the textbook, so this is a controlled situation. So at day 5.5, you have the formation of this basement membrane between the visceral endoderm and the epiblast. Okay, but if WAP6 is not present, you see that this basement membrane cannot form properly. And it's known that beta 1 integrin and beta 1 integrin signaling is key for the formation of this basement membrane. And actually, one possibility to explain this this phenotype, so it's a work done, which a published work done in collaboration with Ludger Johannes. So in fact, what we have shown is that we discussed yesterday about the recycling of integrin. So in fact, there is a pathway that use this, that allow recycling of inactive pool of integrin back to the Golgi complex, probably to be readdressed to the leading edge of the cell. And this this pathway to recycle inactive integrin use RAP6 and all the machinery for this retrograde pathway. So this is maybe why we have this this effect during embryogenesis. Okay, so just briefly, so what we did is to so cross these mice, RAP6 knockout mice, with many mice to to deplete RAP6 in some specific lineage. So I will just show you briefly two examples. So this that has been published. So to study the role of RAP6 during melanogenesis, so we cross these mice with TIR-CRI mice. So it's a work done in cooperation with with Grassa Raposo, also at the Institut Curie. And if you look at these mice, so these mice do not express RAP6 in the melanocyte lineage, and you see that these mice have a pigmentary defect. So now, if you look at melanosome in melanocytes, so in pigmentary cells, so I will not go into detail, but if you lose, so this is normal mouse melanocyte, so taken from RAP6. So this is the control, so this is a melanocyte. And if you, in this RAP6 chaos set, you see that you have much less melanin in these melanosomes. And in fact, so so this is published work, so I'm going too fast, but if you look carefully, so you see, so this this is a melanosome. I'll show you again, and you will see RAP6 vesicles that move to this melanosome. So the interpretation of this data is the following. So in fact, in this cell, RAP6 define pathways that connect directly the Golgi to stage 3 or mature melanosome. And this pathway is important to to transport a set of enzymes to this melanosome. So in fact, in this case, and I think this is why interesting, so the secretory pathway that I told you before is still going on. But in this cell, so in this specialized cell, in fact, part of the circuitry pathway seems to be diverted to this melanosome. And this pathway use the same machinery. So I did not have time to talk, but also this protein ILKS is important for the targeting of this vesicle to the melanosome. So I cannot show you all the data, but I just because it's important for my last message. So, so it's a paper that has just recently been published in Journal of Experimental Medicine. So it's now it's about T cell signaling. So again, so it's collaboration with Claire Ivros, also at the Institut Curie. So now we cross the RAP6 FLOX mice with CD3 mice. So in this case, you deplete RAP6 in T lymphocyte. So just brief introduction. So we are talking now about the T-cell receptor and T-cell signaling. So as you know, there are many proteins involved. And there is a protein called LAT, which is in fact part of this of the T-cell receptor complex. And this protein, in fact, LAT, so cycle between the plasma membrane and a vesicular pool. And so if you look at what is going on in WAP6 knockout mice, so again not going into detail, but in fact you decrease the ability of this cell of the lymphocyte to form immune synapse, and also you have a strong inhibition of T-cell activation, late T-cell activation. And the interpretation of this result, so just to show you briefly the model. So in this case, so again you have WAP6, but now WAP6 do not seem to be directly involved in anterograde transport of LAT or other protein from the Golgi to the membrane, but the phenotype can be explained by an effect, role of WAP6 in the retrograde transport. Okay, so you deplete WAP6 and you inhibit the retrograde transport of LAT, and this is why you have this effect on T-cell signaling. So I go through. So, and this is my conclusion. So, as I show you, so WAP6 seems to be an essential protein that controls many transport steps, but still WAP6 seems to be involved in specific transport steps, depending, in fact, on the cell and the tissue. And so the question that we have now is why? What we believe that can reflect a kind of plasticity of intracellular vesical transport can be a game of effectors. So it's, so I think so. So we try to understand in all these cells and tissue what could be the function of WAP6. And finally, so people that did the work, so most of the work I told today was done by my assistant, Sabine, Stéphanie Misrelanke, PhD student, Amal Kasri, a very good engineer, Hugo, and a former postdoc, Karina, and the main collaboration of Frank Perez, Anudus, Ludger Johannes, Cédric and Grassa Raposo, Claire Ivrose and Marina Glukova. So they are all local collaboration at the Institut Curie. Thank you. Sorry, I've been too long.
The data is really compelling, but it's a very confusing picture because it's like involved in everything. And do you view it more as a general regulator of vesicle formation and then transport and fusion of post-Golgi vesicles, regardless of what the destination is, because you've seen RAP6 and you've implicated RAP6 in secretion now, but before in retrograde transport and also in vesicles coming back to the Golgi. So it's at every step. So is it because you have other specificity determinants, RAVs or ARFs or something that will add specificity to these vesicles, and RAV is just a general factor? Or, as you were saying, in different cell types, RAV6 is doing very specific things, and you're just mixing up cells and all the data, and all together looks like it's doing everything, but then in each cell is just doing one very specific thing.
No, it's a very good question. So actually, this is why we try to do this work in mice. No, I think that RAP6, one of the main functions of RAP6, which is not could be related to retrograde transport. So in post-Golgi trafficking, underground pathway. So I think RAP6 is a major protein involved in the targeting of this vesicle. So along microtubule, they are targeted to this. The role of RAP6 is targeting. So you have RAP6, you have this protein ELKS or CAST, and this targets this vesicle, probably all kind of vesicle that go to the plasma membrane to this site of exocytosis. Okay, so the function of RAP6 in retrograde transport is maybe not disconnected. So this has been shown by maybe not directly, but so RAP6 as a steady state is on the Golgi membrane, and so you have these vesicles that come from endosomes, and now RAP6 could be involved in the, so there is a VPS complex, is a GARP complex, could be involved in the tethering of vesicle coming from endosome with Golgi membrane. So the two situations are, I mean, you can probably the same protein can do the same job at the same time, right, for this.
But what about RAP8 then? What is it doing? Is it different vesicles that are?
RAP8, so Anna Akhmanova has shown is that, in fact, there is a kind of cascade between RAP6 and RAP8. So you have, I mean, so what Anna is thinking is that the vesicles that move, that form from the Golgi are both RAP6 and RAP8 positive. So RAP6 will be involved in targeting to the plasma membrane, and RAP8 will be more involved in the fusion process by itself. But this is not.
Okay, maybe one last question. We'll see. One quick question, and
okay. So, what my question is: indeed, it looks like there is a link to microtubules. But what you described as remarkable is that you have a specific microtubules.
Yeah.
So, how do you think this specificity is achieved? In fact, do you think that those are microtubules that are nucleated locally, and that's why they repeatedly make the same transport those vesicles? And how do you make sure that your vesicles get to the right microtubules?
It's a good question. So, yeah, we believe that, I mean, the microtubules are nucleated. I mean, near this. I mean, now we are doing experiment in cells. Actually, a cap for 50 knockout cells that cannot form microtubule from the Golgi membrane, and this is will be the, I mean, a way to know, I mean, to answer your question.
But in other terms, so you think RAP6 is directing the specificity for specific microtubules?
No, I think it's. I mean, if RAP6 is directly involved in the, I mean the. To nucleate specific microtubules?
No, to make sure that your vesicles stay on the right microtubule.
I don't know.
Because obviously all microtubules are made of the same tubule.
Yeah. I think it's a good question, but we don't know.
We should just go with the panel discussion.